Happy Tuesday to you. We'd like to welcome you to Using Options as a Stock Investor. My name is James Boyd. I normally teach at this time. This is being recorded. If you're watching live, we welcome all of you. And also, if you're watching this recorded, we welcome you to our little session here today as we talk about potential exits and or protection. Is it a live market here today? Are we starting to see some trends change? We got some dark clouds coming. Where are those coming from? And we'll talk about that in just a moment. Just real quick as we're getting started, we have Brent Moores in the chat. You'll see his initials as BM, and you'll notice that he will be teaching later today, exploring thinkorswim. So join us there. Also, quick reminder that if you have questions, I will be looking for those questions, but Brent is going to be really focusing on those questions and answering those questions. So if you see his initials BM in the chat, you know that's Brent Moores, a fellow instructor. Now, just real quick as we hop right in, remember, when we talk about options, like what type of options? Cover calls, collars, cash secured puts, verticals, long synthetics, or let's say synthetics in general. Those would really be the strategies that we focus on, okay? Cover calls would be income, cash secured puts would be income, collars is more about protection, synthetics is really about more about leveraging a trend, okay? Now, so those are the strategies that we really focus on, and verticals. Okay, so let's say five strategies that we could pick from. Now, when we talk about options, remember that options carry a high level risk and are not suitable for all investors. Also understand that the information here is provided for general informational purposes only, not considering an individualized recommendation or endorsement of any particular security, chart pattern, or investment strategy. Other approaches, this webcast discusses technical analysis, but we know there's other approaches like fundamental analysis that may assert some different views. We like to use the combination of both. We will be using the desktop version of the thinkorswim platform. And also remember that all investing involves risk. So what we want to do here today is let's go ahead and hop right in. So first off, we kind of have like a set format of what we do. And I like to kind of, so that's really nice that we have a set format, because sometimes you might be thinking, well, what are we going to do? We kind of imagine that we're managing two different accounts, and some weeks we might be, for example, looking to add a bunch of positions. Other weeks, maybe looking to kind of do protection or income strategies and or exiting. I'm not going to tell you which one we're going to do, but we also want to keep track of where these two portfolios are. These two portfolios we've been following is the margin account, and which we started at 45,000 on 11/15. I want to just take a quick look at where that is as of today. So literally, I'll update that, and it's at 25.2% since 11/15. Now, this is really important because we're trying to get an idea of kind of like how an investor could take a smaller dollar account and then what happens over time, the ups and the downs. The biggest thing is, so that's where the account is now. That's where it started. This account, when you look at the margin account, it's really been since 11/15 almost fully allocated. It's easier to put $45,000 to work, okay, because it's less money. Now, the IRA, well, you're going to notice there, if we scroll down to the IRA, it was at $185,000. It's sitting here at $217,650, if you don't mind, okay? Now, if we look at that one, what you're going to notice is it's at 17.6% since November 15th. Why November 15th? Well, that's when we set up the new, it was about 10 days after we set up the new Schwab YouTube page. Okay, we thought, heck, might as well just reset the portfolio now. Now, if we look at the S&P, this is a kind of a really important, we take a look at this as we start to go into agenda items. The SPX since 11/15 is right around 16.37%. Now, the IRA account, just so we all know, it's about half cash, okay? So remember, the only way you get the SPX, if you bought something that tracks the SPX, okay, the SPX being the cash index, can't buy the SPX stock-wise. But if we look at the return, 16.37%, that's assuming that you fully invested all the money. This right here on the IRA was not fully invested. It was about 50% invested, 50% cash. Okay. Some of you might kind of think about that and say, oh, geez, that's interesting. What you invested in must have had a pretty decent return if you were sitting 50% in cash. About. That's true. Okay. Now, let's kind of talk about, so those are, that's where those two portfolios are. I want to kind of go out there and kind of take a look at some of these clouds that we might see in the marketplace. Speaking of clouds, if you're in Oklahoma or Texas or Missouri or Kansas, you know something about clouds. Last night, the rainstorms that went through there yesterday, my family's there, so I saw those. It was like free swimming, okay, right in the middle of the streets. Now, what I'm going to do is let's kind of pull up the SPX to begin with, okay? Now, the SPX, and let me kind of take this bottom off for just a second. And if we look at this, what you're going to notice is on the SPX, tell me what you see on the SPX, and I'll zoom in pretty hard on the right-hand side. What do you notice? Okay. Now, the biggest thing is that we're really watching is the color of the moving averages. Okay. Watching the color of the moving averages, the 10 and the 20. What do we have so far on the 10? It's red. Okay. What about the 20, the lagging period moving average? It's still green. Now, the one thing is we want to kind of keep an eye on is where is this diagonal support? So when we have diagonal support, that probably tells us we've been in an uptrend. And boy, have we ever. Yeah. Now, if we take a look at this, this upward move, if you want to kind of draw a line, maybe be something like that. Or if we kind of take it like something like this, maybe right there. I don't think it matters. If we draw going back, and how far do we go back? As far as you can, okay? If we go back and look at the last couple months, we're sitting right now on that diagonal support. So this is critical, okay? Now, what we know on the SPX, when you zoom in on this, there is a little one top, boo, two top, and so we're getting a little double top. So this is going to be very important. Now, this kind of now kind of brings up to, let's kind of put some key points here. Sitting on diagonal support, okay, with a double top. Okay, tell me what strategies, okay, what strategies might the investor be thinking? If we're sitting on diagonal support, if there's a double top, right, what type of strategies, if you see on the chart, I see a defined level of resistance, I see, for example, that we're maybe losing momentum. What type of strategies? Oh, let's buy a long call. That's probably not what we're going to be looking for. This is kind of more strategies thinking like, what about exits? Just exiting, flat out exiting. We'll talk about that in just a sec. The second strategy we might be thinking about, if we had 100 shares, okay, we need 100 shares plus. Now, why are you writing this down? Because I want to be very concrete of what we get to, okay? So flat out exiting. And I want to kind of go back to this for just a sec. Why would someone just look to exit? Let's be clear on this. Why would someone look just to say, look, I want to exit? Why do they do that? Well, probably they want a profit take. That's number one. Number two, they might not have, they don't have 100 plus shares, okay? Part of this might be that they might have, let's say, more invested, a higher percent. And so maybe they want to actually increase cash. Now, this is going to be that last point is very huge, because if the investor has more invested, they have options. Like if I sell one or the investor sells one, they have other positions. Okay. And that's a big one. But if the investor says, I only have two positions, they're probably not going to exit because they only have two positions. Okay. So the biggest thing is if we take a look at this, why are they exiting? Which actually the comment came in from Paul. Paul said loss. I'm going to kind of say that there's a more of a higher percent of max gain. Okay. Now, what I want to do here in this case is, so when we look at the SPX, you know, you got to imagine that most stocks will probably look like the SPX on a majority basis Probably going to see a lot of stocks with double tops. Probably going to see a lot of stocks falling down below the moving averages. And maybe having one or both moving average lines red. Now, just really quick, I want to define this, okay? We should not have to look at a chart. If I ask Paul a question like, hey, Paul, what is your exit on stocks? Well, pull up the chart and I'll show you. I don't think that's the answer, okay? What is the exit of a stock position? Type it in the chat. Now, if we're talking about, let's say, a quicker exit, 10-day moving average, red only, okay? And we said, why would an investor do that? We just listed them, okay? They probably want a profit take. They don't have 100 shares. They have more invested. They want to increase cash, okay? That would probably be more like the margin account. They have a higher percent of maximum gain. They don't have that much upside left, okay? If we want, let's say, more confirmation, okay, we're talking about both lines on moving average, red. And if we're talking about kind of, let's say, more confirmation, both moving average lines, red, with a crossover. And I'm talking about an MA crossover. Now, this just sounds so easy when you write it down. Don't worry, I'm going to test you here today. I'm going to test you emotionally, okay? Because when we go to sell something, it's like, maybe I don't want to do that. It seems so easy when it's written down, but to pull the trigger, so to say, now it all of a sudden it seems hard, okay? Now, what we're going to look today is we've got a number of stocks that we're going to look at, and we're going to try to use these as a reference points, a sample trading plan to execute those. You can write anything down you want. It doesn't mean you follow it, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to try to be numb to what's happening on the chart. Numb, okay? Now, what we're going to do is before we get there, we're going to just take a quick look at the NDX, okay? And what you notice on the NDX, that's a little drop. We might even say that the NDX kind of getting back in, say, let's say, a channel, if you will, base, resistance, or resistance. Now, if you take a look at this, what type of strategy might you consider on tech stocks that are sitting in a range? Geez, covered calls, collars seem pretty likely. It could be verticals where you're in a tighter range. Now, if you look at, let's say, the Dow Jones itself, Dow even dropped, okay? Getting back inside that range, and your Russell 2000, huh, it just doesn't like going up, okay? Not horrible, but it's back inside that prior area or range. What are the headwinds of stocks? Well, let's just start out with that crude oil stuff, okay? Crude oil, okay? We see that crude oil, now, by the way, Thursday at 9:30 a.m. Eastern, we will be re-kicking off the futures class. Not a recommendation of futures, okay? But we will have a class for futures restarting back up like we did before, okay? Now, what you're going to notice is if you look at CL, the oil price itself for that expiration been going up. We see gold that has also been shooting up. Many of you have been right on top of that. Okay, pretty high. We're also seeing that when you look at, let's say, silver, not coming along, opposite direction there. Copper, when you take a look at copper, not coming along there as well. It's really gold and actually oil. Yeah. Now, the one other thing that we have a little headwind on is interest rates. Okay, interest rates affect us in so many ways. How much do you get paid on your savings? Or how much you pay on debt, okay, short-term and long-term. Not a great sign if you start to see that break out of this range. That would be an increased borrowing cost potential and actually a compression of potential future profits. Higher borrowing cost, okay, decreases the chance that you actually could have profits. And also, you're going to see that that's having, and now, by the way, that's not just on the 10-year, the TNX. It's also on the maturity of the 30-year as well, okay? So don't like to see that. stocks like kind of a neutral range of interest rates, and they also like, for example, rates that are dropping where the borrowing costs of companies, individuals could be lower. So we're kind of seeing some of these headwinds here. And with this kind of this double top moving averages kind of coming down a little bit, or at least turning somewhat red, we're seeing that volatility, we're seeing that volatility kicking back up a little bit. Now, it's not breaking out above, let's say, 15 and a half, 16, but it's at least popping a little bit. And what does that show us to sign up? Maybe some investors thinking about protected puts, collars, maybe willing to buy protection to try to lock in their gains. So what we want to do now is let's go take a quick look at some of the positions and let's kind of look to practice what we just talked about. We know what we're likely going to see based on what we saw in indexes. Okay. Now let's go look to practice. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the monitor tab. Let's bring up the margin account first. What I want to do is I want to bring up a couple. So this kind of also brings back to the question, what does an investor look at first? Stock positions or option positions? Okay. Can anyone answer that question? Which thing to look at first? Well, some investors might choose stock positions. There's more capital involved. There's a higher delta. If that stock starts going down $1, $2, $3, $4, $5, it's more sensitive to direction. So when we look down through this table, anything that would have like 100 delta or be a stock position, we know what would be a stock position because it would not have gamma or theta or vega. If we just use the Greeks itself, it would just have a delta of 100, representing 100 shares of stock with no other Greeks involved. Now, what you're going to notice is this is a stock position. This is a stock position because there's no gamma, theta, vega. There's only delta, the directional sensitivity, okay, to a $1 move up or down. So first off, the investor is probably going to look at stock positions. One stock position that we might want to just double check on is CAH. Now, CAH, what you're going to notice is it's 100 shares of stock. What we're now going to go do is say, look, we're going to use this as a foundation. Now, before I show you the chart, this is down $47. That has no meaning at all. None. We're going to go look at the chart, CAH. Now, $56,000, there's $6,000 of cash. What might make an investor consider just to exit? Well, we made mention of that. If they had more invested and they wanted to increase cash, they might go look for positions where they might just sell the position. If you zoom in on CAH, what you're going to notice is, geez, kind of looks like it's stuck in a symmetrical triangle. Hasn't hit the stop, but it's in a land of nowhere. Now, the stock is sitting flat. If the paper money portfolio sells this, the cash could sit flat, okay? Now, if we look at this Cardinal Health, we also go look and say, well, geez, I wonder what the neighborhood is doing. Funny we should ask the question. If we pull it up, what is the neighborhood doing? Well, it's pretty ugly, right? And if we look at the neighborhood, if the neighborhood drops, then what's the likelihood that the stock might go down? Might. Any taker on that? What's the likelihood that CAH would go down if the neighborhood is dropping? It becomes more probable. So one thing that we're going to do here is we're $50,000 of the $56,000 invested. We're trying to increase cash. We're trying to get positions off the table that really aren't going anywhere right now. So what we're going to do is we're going to move this stop up, click and drag it up, and we're going to move it right to the current price or right near it. And we're going to try to sell the position, okay? Now, if we do that, what you're going to notice is, James, based on what we said before, what type of sell is this? It's really based upon the shorter-term moving average, red, okay? And it's right there. So now it hasn't filled yet. That stop is right there. If we go to 111.17, it's going to trigger to sell. I'll move it up just a little bit so we can get it off the books. Send it. Okay, what did it fill at? 111.20, which is at the current price. So what does that do? It takes our cash from 6,000 to a 17,000. That was huge. That raises the cash like 20%, okay, at least. So the biggest thing is that's an example of just kind of going in and saying, what's the likelihood of actually this going up when the neighborhood's going down? And it's also an example of using example A, let's just kind of label as number one exit, selling it quicker. And we said, why might an investor do that? Well, they probably have, they have a higher percent of the portfolio invested. They're trying to increase cash, okay? Now, the second one we're going to go down and look at, PG. Now, PG has 131 shares. Now, why are you focusing on the stock positions? We're focusing on the stock positions because that has the greatest sensitivity to direction, higher delta. It also might be something that we could, has a higher capital invested as well. Could we look to do maybe like a covered call, a collar, something like that? Okay. Now, if we pull up, let's say, PG itself and say, what do we got here? Well, I think we would at least say it's kind of formed a double top. And again, we said that before. When you look at the index, when we look at many of these stocks, they're going to be showing something pretty similar. Now, what you're going to notice is we have 131 shares. So what would you probably consider first? If you had, let's say, 131 shares, an investor might say, I'm going to sell the extra 31 shares. Get it down to 100 shares. We're going to, and that's why we might say going forward, just try to do in increments or close as you can to 100 or 200, et cetera, if you can. I cancel those stops and the targets. We're going to right-click on that line, create closing order. We're going to go in and sell 31 shares, okay? We're going to sell 31 shares to get down to 100. Just a little trimming. It's like we're doing investing gardening class 101, okay? Now, if we take a look at this, just selling 31. Send. Now, what would you maybe consider if you had, let's say, a defined level resistance and 100 shares of stock? What would you consider? Now, here's the thing. People think about all kinds of stuff. We're just thinking about what is a strategy that would be more neutral. You have 100 shares and maybe want downside protection. Well, we have three options. Mainly, we could do a cover call, which the income is the protection, but the risk is still down to zero. We could buy a protective put itself, but you got to pay for it, okay? And it has an expiration. And the third really is the combination of those two. Selling a call for a gain or credit, and then using that credit to pay for the put, the collar. Of the three, you know, we really talk about the cover call and the collar the most. Okay? So how do we call our position? Well, we're going to try to actually sell. So my main point with this is every time if we kind of said, well, what type of scenario do we have on the moving averages? Well, is it number one? Is it number two or is it number three? Well, this right here, what you're going to notice is it's really more number three. Red lines, and there was already a crossover back here. So every time we get this, it does not mean the investor has to sell the stock. For some investors, they may want to use options as a way to protect the stock position, like we're going to show now. Whenever we sell something, we're trying to have something shorter dated so that obligation is not as far out into the future. Okay? We're going to go down to the May expiration. Now, typically, if you're going to sell something, you want to try to, and this is just in real life too, you're trying to sell it higher than what you bought it for, obviously. Second part is you think, hey, I want to try to sell it where I don't think the stock could get up to or past. Now, there's a balance here. If you sell it too high, the strike price, there's no premium. So we could say, I'm going to sell the 180s, and you say, geez, they're only going to give me 10 cents or 10 bucks. Exactly. So there's a balance between something pretty close to where we are now, but maybe where there's also a lesser chance of the stock closing above that strike. Well, let's go look on the chart and see where is 165. 165 is really way up here. It's not even on the chart. Okay. Now, what you're going to notice is if we sell the 165, they're going to really give a premium of about $1.48. Now, when someone sees the market going down, they're typically not concerned about the stock going up. They're more concerned about the downside. So what the investor is going to do is they're going to use the premium from the call side to buy the put. Okay? Now, how many of you have ever said to yourself, geez, I wish I would have maybe bought protection? Well, why didn't you buy protection if you had 100 shares? I had to pay for it. Well, this what's interesting about this is very close to what we call a no-cost collar. So what that really means is if I right-click on this 146, sell, and we're going to go right to where it says caller synthetic. Now, what this is doing is if we look at the credit we receive from the 165 call and we put this to a 155, this is now going to put a bracket around the trade. The top side is the 165 call. The bottom side is the 155, okay? When does that 155 have value? It has value when the stock actually approaches the 155 or goes lower than 155. When might the investor want to exercise that right? When it's valuable, or maybe the stock is below that strike. Now let's think about this logically. Let's say 45 days from now, the stock is at 130. Would you rather hold on to the stock at 130, or would you rather have a right to and exercise that right to sell the shares at 155? I mean, it's your shares. What would you rather do? I think many investors would say, you know what? I got that sheet of paper. I would like to sell the shares at 155 and sell that option, okay, and get out of the shares even. So what you're going to notice is how much is it going to cost us to protect? Well, it's going to be 19 cents or $19 plus the commission of $1.30. So for $20, we're going to protect the position. And what this is going to do is it's going to get the delta down on the position. What do we mean by that? Get the delta down. Well, remember, if you have 100 shares of stock, and let's say you, for example, sell a call and buy a put, it's going to reduce the delta probably down to about 30. So if the stock were going to go down, it's not going to be losing the same amount compared to a person that has 100 shares just by itself. So the investor is trying to just decrease or kind of be in a protective crouch position if that trend is not really in their favor, like it's not right now. We're going to go ahead and send that order, and it fills. Now, when we look at the position, what you're now going to notice is 100 shares of stock, short call, and that long put. Now, the delta for the strikes that we picked is going to get to the net delta of 43, okay? So if the stock were going to go down a dollar net, we'd probably be down about $43 instead of just being down $100 if we just kept the shares. So it's trying to decrease the loss for every dollar the stock goes down. It's trying to have some protection. This protection lasts for 45 days. Now, the ultimate question happens, such as, when would you get out of the position? Well, I think it goes back to, we would like to see this stock get back above 162.63. If we got it back above 162.63, we'll exit that short call. Until then, carry on, because it's still in a range. Now, when would you get out of the, let's say, get out of the position entirely? We've always talked about if that stock were going to be in the week of expiration and set to close below the long put strike, look to exit everything, okay? Now, we got some time before we get there. But if we're in the week of expiration in May, and the stock is set to close below 155, we're talking about buying the callback, selling the put, and selling the shares. That one's just kind of like it either is or isn't. What happens if in the week of expiration you're still in between the strikes? You might want to roll it. And last but not least, if that stock were to break above 162.63 after 9 or 10 days, we've always talked about that, we could look to really buy that callback. We'll put an alert right now, right click, create an alert. And what we're just saying in this case is consider buying callback, question mark. Why? Uncap the upside. Okay. Uncap upside potential. So the biggest thing I need you to understand is if you're a stock investor only, you just get in and out. This is interesting because we're not getting rid of the stock position. We're using options to change the Greeks. And the Greek that we're really focused on changing is delta. Delta is, again, showing us the change in the stock price given the change in the option price. And if the investor is saying that trend is not in my favor, they're saying I want lower delta. If the stock is going more in their favor, they might want higher delta. Okay? So in this case, we're going to go ahead and create that. This is just an alert. Now what we're going to go ahead and actually do is that now position is sitting there. Our goal so far, and I want to go to questions, is we're trying to use rules to kind of drive the routine, okay? That's what we're doing. We're not looking at emotion. We're just saying, can you execute the plan, okay? So let me just do one more just real quick. Let me just give you an example given. If I were to look at, let's say, SPG, 34 shares of stock, and if I were to go to SPG, okay, and I said, okay, what do we have here? You're going to see that we have a shorter term moving average line that so far is still red. Now, if we said that this portfolio wants to increase cash, they might say, I'm going to use number one exit, where it's using a very short term exit methodology. And the investor might say, James, I'm going to go in and just sell. Now, it hasn't broken support, but the investor might say, look, I'm trying to raise some capital. And it sold those 34 shares of stock. Now notice, we were at $6,000 of cash. And about two trades, we went from $6,000 of cash to $27,000 of cash. So when you said, well, what percent of this account is now cash? It's about 50% cash, 50% invested. So now if the market goes down, what will we probably see? This account might outperform because it doesn't have all of it invested. I think a lot of people overlook two things. Number one, selling two or three or four positions can make a significant difference a lot of times on how much is invested. Okay. Number two, they're not using callers as a way to decrease delta. Callers is a foundational concept to learn how to say, look, when the trend's not in my favor, I don't have to sell the stock, the investor says. I can just look to be in a protected position for a certain period of time. Now, the goal of this section was I want less. So a lot of times people talk about this is my exit. That's very nice. Show me examples where you did what you said your plan was. That's the brass tacks. Because I'm not, so here's the deal. I'm not mad that the portfolio gives back money. But where the investor might be mad is when they said, dadgummit, son of a gun, I knew better. That's really where you get frustrated, right? I knew better and I didn't follow it. That's where that frustration comes in. Now, someone right now is saying, why is he yelling? Well, because you feel frustrated. And sometimes you have to kind of either say, okay, I got to stop doing what I'm thinking and actually do what's in my plan. And as soon as you come to that realization, the better. Okay. Now, let's go ahead. And so Eva says, how do I define cash heavy? So this is a good question. I'm not really sure if there's like a defined number, but so the comment she said, so if we look at right now, she made a comment that if you were 80% cash, is that cash heavy? I mean, so what does that mean? You have 20% invested in something, okay? And for us, it's going to be stocks and options, okay? Let's say the investor had 20% cash, 20% invested in stocks and options, 80% cash, would you guys and gals be okay to say that's pretty heavily invested? If someone said to us that we were maybe 50% cash, 50% invested, I would probably, we might be thinking they're kind of thinking more neutrality. Short term in the market. Now, before we came in today, this was really 90 to 95% invested, 5 to 10% cash. And if we kind of said, well, what's that type of person? Well, the less cash you have, the more bullish you are. So now what you're going to notice is, now, by the way, we are sitting right now at this. So, Eva, I agree with you. Like, when you talk about what is cash heavy, I think for some investors, if you start getting more than 70% cash, you are becoming more defensive, say the least. Anything higher than probably 70%, example given. That can vary for some people, but I think we probably could find some common ground there. If we're 50% cash, 50% invested, in the keyword, the short term, they might be saying, look, the market looks like it, or some of these stocks are going sideways, and I just want to have a little bit more cash. That way, if things were to drop to get down to some more short-term technical levels, they might want to have some cash available to deploy, keyword deploy. There's nothing worse, okay, than when the market drops, you don't have any money. Because you held on to those stocks after they showed exit signals and you rode them all the way down, and now you're just hoping to get back to break even. Okay, I know you guys have never done that, but I know someone that did that, okay? So the purpose of trying to raise some cash earlier into the sell-off is that way if they were to drop down to some interesting technical levels, the investor has some options to invest, okay? Yeah, Paul says no powder. Paul, it looks like me and you are going to be really good friends here. I like that. Okay, now here it is. Now, Lewis actually says discipline, okay? And that's why I kind of said is you have to, consider in making it more just like you're doing a job. The job is to manage the portfolio based upon your sample exit rules. Okay. Now, what I want to do is just real quick as just see if, now what I want to do is I want to go back to just real quick. One other, let's take a look at that. Well, what about an option position? Okay. One thing we want, so we kind of spent some time talking about using options for stocks, but what about positions like Disney? Okay. Now, what is another strategy that the investor would probably be concerned about? Well, we said before, number one is we'll probably be concerned about stock positions. Okay, let's find that right there. Which one's first? Stock positions, yes. Okay, we talked about why. What type of option positions? The number one position we would be concerned about is a cash secured put, which is delta, positive delta, that is dynamic, meaning if that stock were going to go down, the delta increases. I can't even. Okay. And it's scary for some investors because they're like, wait, I thought the delta was 30 to 40 when I sold it initially. Yeah, but it changes based upon what the stock does. And if that stock goes down, the delta gets bigger, meaning the losses get bigger. That's why I went like that. Now, the other part of this is it's positive vega. What in the world does that mean? No, it's actually negative vega. So what it actually means is if the volatility were to increase, it inflates that option price, making it more expensive to buy back. Now, wait, why is that bad? Well, if you sold it for $2 and then all of a sudden the VIX goes up to 50, what do you think that the put's going to be worth now? Okay, more than what you sold it for, highly likely, right? And all of a sudden, we're trying to see, the thing is, we're trying to sell high, buy low. We're not trying to sell high and buy back higher, because if you buy back higher, you have. What's the point? Why do we actually say the stocks are the most important, then followed by cash secure put? Because they're not delta stationary. They move positively as the stock goes down, which there's more risk. And the biggest thing is it's short vega. The risk is volatility expands. Example given. So if we look at Disney, the other part of this is when we look at Disney, we might ask ourselves the question, how much of that premium do we have? Well, it was sold for $3.30 and now it's at $2.47. It's up $82. Now, you got to be very careful here, okay? Some investors might say, well, I want more gains. Question is, are you likely going to get those gains? Let's pull up Disney. I want us to talk about, do we see any sell signals yet? See any sell signals yet? Based upon what we talked about. Well, we never talked about the price going down below the moving average. If the price is going down below the moving average, what does that give us a higher likelihood of having? Well, it'd be a higher likelihood of really getting the shorter term moving average line to turn red. Hasn't done that yet. And remember, we're just following the sample rule set, right? If we said, okay, we're looking for the shorter term moving average to go red, it's not there yet. Let's say later today that it was. We could manually go in and let's just imagine, hypothetically, that it was red right now. The nice thing about these options is we do not have to wait all the way to the expiration to get out. Now, if I right-click on this and create closing order, we're going to buy it back. And number one is this decreases the directional sensitivity by buying it back, okay, exiting here. Second thing is we're trying to do is get short vega off, okay? What has short vega? Covered calls and cash secured puts. Anytime we sell something by itself, sell a call, sell a put, negative vega. Now, we're playing it, we're kind of making the assumption. Let's say today the shorter term moving average is red. How would we just exit that short put? Now, the investor might say, yeah, but I'm only up 25%. I want more. Well, what does I want more have to do with your plan? It doesn't. Okay. So this is where you have to kind of leave yourself at home and go back to your rule set. It's not about what the investor thinks if you're trading a rule set. It's about being numb and trading the rule set. Okay. So now what we're going to do is create closing order. We're going to buy it back. Now, by the way, you can do whatever you want, okay? But if we're trading a rule set, we're just going to be numb, and we're just going to say, okay, we're kind of doing the example, wonder if today Disney's shorter-term moving average line is red. How could the investor buy these short options back? It only has 25%, but some investors might want to take one in the hand and two in the bush, okay? Now, all the cash secured puts are not going to have 100% gain. Some might only have a little bit, then get an exit signal, and might have some gains left. Now, I'm going to put it at 249 there. The mark was at 248, and it got filled. Okay? So now what you're going to notice is Disney, that is off the table. So now the biggest thing is when you look at this portfolio and said, do we have any other options that are short vega? Answer, you got Amazon and Meta. Now, if we had a little bit more time, which I'm just going to take a quick peeky, if we looked at this and said, are there any other short puts here that we might evaluate for profit potential? The answer, the one that we could actually look to see if there's an exit signal on is the 177 put for Amazon. Now, it only has $48. I want more. I want more has nothing to do with your sample plan. Well, maybe yours is in there. Maybe you're like, I want more until I get it. Okay. Maybe it's in there. I don't know. I'll just have a little fun with you. Amazon is like Disney. It's not showing the red moving average yet, but we know if the price is below it could be. Okay. Keep an eye on that as well. I'm out of my time here today. We're going to be having Barbara Armstrong coming up next with Getting Started with Options. We talked about today using a rule subset to guide the investment process. We talked about stock examples. We also brought up the option examples. We talked about what the investor might look at first and why to kind of guide a thought process. Remember, with what we talked about here today, it was done for educational purposes only. Thank you to Brent. Thanks to all of you. And what I want you to do today from a homework assignment is review your rule set for exiting. That could be the stock position, or if you're talking about exiting, not exiting the stock, practicing entering options as protection. Example given callers. Practice that. Stay tuned for Barbara coming up next. And if you have not subscribed to this channel on YouTube, subscribe. We'd love to actually have you, and you'd be able to see all of our upcoming classes and current classes. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.